Welcome everybody to Jodie LA. Tonight my guest is Eddy Medora. He is a singer, musician, artist, and we could go on and on and on. Hello there.
Hi.
So great to have you here.
Oh, it's terrific.
And I should say a schoolmate of mine, and we graduated about a year ago?
About,
I saw you at the reunion?
About a year and a half ago.
Haven't changed a bit. How are you?
I'm doing fine.
This is wonderful to have you on. It really is.
Well, it's so nice to be here only because I feel like I'm in my backyard. Where we grew up. I grew up on the West Side, as you well know.
Mm-hmm.
Pacific Palisades was my first home. And when I come over and I smell the ocean, I go, why did I move?
Isn't it wonderful? Well, I'm the same thing, born and raised here. So.
But you're still here. So.
And I'm still here.
See,
I'm still looking at the sun.
Yes. Pacific Ocean Park, beach, surfing, you know, whatever, sunsets,
yes.
Restaurants.
Yes.
And of course, most of my friends have moved because they made so much money on their homes.
Mm-hmm.
That you're able to sit there and go elsewhere up the beach where it might be less expensive.
Right.
But anyways, it's very nice to be in Santa Monica.
Well, when I met you, it was Hollywood Professional School.
Yes.
Which was a school for kids who were in show business.
Well, HPS brings back a lot of memories. If it wasn't for Hollywood Professional, I probably wouldn't be here, obviously, talking to you this evening. But the school had memories because the teachers were very young. And they drew very straight lines when they taught us algebra.
Uh-huh.
And but the nice part, we got off a little afternoon, 1 o'clock.
That's right.
And they
did this
because you could work on your craft, whether you're a model, an artist, musician, whatever it might be. And it was hell talking my dad and let me go to this school.
Oh, sure.
But when we went there, and I say we, my little band at that time, we said, why didn't we get here earlier? What a place. I mean, what a memory. We were there about 2.5, almost 3 years, graduated from there.
So you're there all through your high school years, right?
1 year at St. Monica's, 1 year at Palisades High, and the other 2.5 years at HPS. And then summer schools at Uni High and SAMO High, everybody.
Oh, SAMO High, sure.
Yeah, that was fun. And I did good in those summer school things.
You went to summer school?
Yeah, I did that because I was surfing during the regular part of the school and playing music when you should have been
studying.
Studious.
So what's the first band that you were in?
Well, a quick story. It's interesting.
Yeah.
Somebody asked me that the other day, how somebody gets in a band and how you start a band at 15 or 14. We were in eighth grade. And it was at Palisades Park Recreation Center, and there was a dance that night. So I went there with a couple of friends of mine, and all of a sudden there was a band called the Riptides. And they had a record called Machine Gun. For all you trivia people out there, Machine Gun with John Hudson. We went nuts over this band. We went and bought the record. We learned it. That was the start of the band. Later on, 40 years? Well, since it was 1958, 59, 60, the band Renegade started with an R because of the Riptides, played at all the fraternity parties around the West Side, the house band at the Club Deauville right by the Santa Monica Pier.
Yes.
We were the house band there. Backed up people like Chuck Berry, Bobby Day, The Twist, what's his name, Chubby Checker, and we were sort of like a background house band for any group that was starring there. But how it all comes around, Kate Hudson's grandfather was the drummer in the Riptides.
Oh.
Whoever knows Kate Hudson. And I didn't find this out till I got on the internet to get on the Riptides site.
Mm-hmm.
And then it did say that the Hudson brothers and
right.
Blah, blah, blah. And I went, oh, my God. So thank you, Kate. Thank you, John, for my little short-lived career from the Riptides to the Renegades to then the Sunrays.
That's when I knew you.
And that's what happened. I got to the school at Hollywood Professional. And after I went to the school at Hollywood Professional, we had Odd Call. Remember Odd Call?
Of course.
And everybody got to perform. Everybody got to say and sing and model and play and jam.
Yes.
And you had to wear a suit.
Yes.
And the girls had to wear a dress.
High heels. Yes.
Yeah. So that taught us another dimension of growing up.
It was on Fridays.
On Fridays. So as we went to perform, Carl Wilson and Dennis and Dave Marks was entering the school, and they heard our band, which still were the Renegades. Well, they freaked out. They thought we were sensational musicians. And I think we were, because all we did, we weren't into sports at that time. We did nothing but play music on the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
And so he said, my dad's looking for, I say he, Carl Wilson said, my dad's looking for another band to manage. And I said, yeah, you just want him off your butt, which is true. So I would be setting Carl up with some of the girls at school. Ooh. I won't mention them. I'll tell you after.
Okay.
And pimping. And basically, we did get the interview with Murray Wilson. And Murray, we auditioned at his Hawthorne house, and he said he kept us till 4 in the morning. Taught us how to sing five-part harmony. Mm-hmm. And then after that, he says, if you listen to me, you'll have a hit in 6 weeks.
Was he on, as rough on you as he was on his
No,
kids?
That's a whole other, that's my book that I'm writing,
oh,
I'm in the
oh.
middle of.
Oh, okay.
But that's what it's going to discuss. It's going to discuss how wonderful this man was to us. Verbally, he might have been a verbal abusive, but not physically. Mm-hmm. Never saw him raise a hand to any of the sons or us. It was always the pulling of, I want it this way, because he was a musician too. He could write and sing and play the piano and arrange. And the boys, meaning, you know, Brian and those guys, they wanted it their way because they were excelling too musically, mm-hmm. where Murray sort of stayed there. In fact, one of our records on the album, Sunrays album, was called Still, and that killed our career. And it was a love song to his wife Audrey, and they were having arguments. So we had to do this Bill Anderson country western song, which was a complete divorce from what we were doing, mm-hmm. as a surf five-part harmony band, which we were really a blues band in the Renegades. So we went from blues to five-part to surf and now to country, which really confused our audience.
Were you friends with Carl in school?
Very,
Carl
very
Wilson went to
yeah,
our school.
We went to the prom together. I set him up
with... You were dates?
Yes. Thank you're going to get it. We were dates. But it's funny, we were almost, because what happened was he bought me a tux.
Uh-huh.
He bought me the shirt with my initials in it, the ruffles.
Mm-hmm.
I had to buy my own boots, because that's what you wore in the 60s.
Yeah.
And I believe the grad night was at the Beverly...
Hills
Beverly
Hotel.
Hills Hotel.
That's right.
Yeah. And after that, we went to the Sea Witch and to the... I can't remember all the clubs up and down the strip where the Comedy Store, Ciro's, and some... And we sat in.
Mm-hmm.
We asked the band if we could, you know, sing to our dates at that time, play guitar. And they didn't know who he was and who I was. I mean, if he had his, all his brothers there, probably knew we were. So we didn't get home until about 5 in the morning. We went bowling. You know that bowling alley?
Yes.
Yeah, we went bowling. And that's what you did back then in the prom, guys, is you try to have a long time, stretch it out, and try to remember your prom. Well, I mean, I remember grad night as well as the prom. And so Carl did keep his promise. We did have the audition. Murray did keep his word. We did have a hit record 6 weeks later. He said, go home and write. Go home and write, guys. Just keep writing.
Mm-hmm.
So we did some of his songs, which didn't fare too well. And Ricky and I wrote most of the songs on the album. Ricky had I Live for the Sun and Andrea, which are two big hits. And then Still actually made the charts, made top 50, and then died. And then we toured from 64 to 69, 1969. So it was a nice long thing, but we're still going to college.
Mm-hmm.
Each of us are still went to college, got our degrees. And we booked our tours around that, where we were able to go on the road with the Beach Boys. Sometimes we went on the road with the Stones our first trip, which
oh,
was
really?
Really exciting, and we didn't know why they were screaming. And we found out they were in the same hotel, that we were going to be on the same bill in Jacksonville, uh-huh. Florida, which is sort of exciting.
Sure.
And that's when they first came aboard with their first record, Satisfaction. So we performed with a lot of bands and a lot of great singers. And I think that during the 60s there was a lot of bands, great bands, mm-hmm. and great singers. So I'm very privileged to share the stage and the spotlight with some of these groups.
I think we have some pictures of you with the Sunrays, don't we? We can put up on the screen. I think we do. We can have them. Yeah, there you go.
Oh, now that's the old Renegades. That's our brocaded jackets, and that is at the Club Deauville, if I'm not right, in Santa Monica.
That was right on the Coast Highway, isn't it?
Right on the Coast Highway to the right of the Santa Monica Pier, and we were there every single Friday and Saturday night for 2 years.
Wow.
And that's my 21st birthday with Carl Wilson and his first wife, Annie.
Uh-huh.
And my wife, Ann, too. And then it's Billy of Billy, Desi, and Dino in the back. He
right.
just had his hit, so that was at my house, and Carl was finishing up this cake that I baked for him. In thanking him for introducing us to his dad. Now, that's at school. That's Mickey Rooney Jr. on the far left, me uh-huh. with the dark tan from surfing. Marty, who was in my band, and John Engel from the Walker Brothers. So John Walker from the Walker Brothers. The sun ain't going to shine anymore, and is now married to Kathy Young.
Yeah.
And that's us singing I Live for the Sun. You can see how far back that goes with the old RCA mics that
they
use.
And I think we even have I Live for the Sun here, don't
no.
we?
No.
Don't we?
Oh, that would be awesome.
Do we have it here?
Sun, 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 sun.
There we go.
Found it. That's pretty cool stuff. That's us at the Disneyland. We were the house band there for almost 3 years.
For the sun,
and they made us cut our hair.
Uh-huh.
And they put us outside because we didn't cut our hair. That's why we were freezing. It was around Christmas time. It was a lot of fun.
I loved that song.
Yeah, it was sort of nice.
It was very bouncy.
Yeah. There's been a lot of cover songs. Punk rock. Dennis Dragon did something on the Surf Punks. He did a fun version of that for the song.
And then those were the days of fun music. You know?
I wrote a song about Joanne on there.
Oh, really?
I wrote two. I wrote one called "I'm Tired of You."
True. Was this before marriage or after?
After. No, actually, it was before. Yeah.
Before you got married.
Oh no, I wouldn't do it after. Then she'd have to get the royalty checks came in. You know, the $3 ones. Uh-huh. But no. So after the Sunrays went away, there was sort of a void. A big void, because you know you had the best manager going on. We got paid. We did the American Bandstand and all the teen shows, Shindig, Shivery, and it's all over with. And you take a deep breath and you go, now what?
Now what?
So, for me, I kept going to school, got a degree in art, was going to work for Hal Pereira, design half of LA, the Pereira Associates. Mm-hmm. I didn't. I ended up managing Barker Brothers Furniture Stores, being a head designer for 5 years, which was sort of fun because I did people who are no longer with us. So I did Lauren Green's house. I did Dean Martin's summer house in Palm Springs. Mm-hmm. And I did Jimmy Durante's house.
Wow.
And it was so nuts. I saw them all the same sofa. And I asked them, I said, you guys
have cocktail parties?
That's all I need. So I said, if it's good enough for your tuchus, it's good enough for mine. I gave myself this beautiful leather sofa that they didn't even make back then. I mean, these were all custom made back then. And I had one made. And of course, what happens when you get married, the wife wants you to get rid of it because it's too masculine. And I ended up selling a $3,000 sofa that was in still great shape for like $200. And we had to cover it in white cotton so I could keep it one more year. So let me have one more year, we'll cover it in white. Mm-hmm. And so finally these people were so happy when I sold them. I said, you got two sofas in one, dude, look. Just zip it off, you got suede here and you got cotton on the top, you know. But so Barker Brothers left, and then all of a sudden I kept trying to get a job at Disney as an artist. Probably 9 interviews, and they finally call me.
Yeah.
I was managing the Barker Brothers Santa Monica store. In fact, every store that I managed, they closed. I don't want to go there, why that happened. The Hollywood store across the street from the Chinese theater. I closed that store, I closed Glendale. I won't tell you all the stores I closed, but Santa Monica I closed right after I was done with it. And they said, would you like to come to work for Walt Disney Records? And I said, what's that? Now, mind you, what's that? We all grew up with this, and I'm going, what's that? So I went in for like 3 interviews, and I didn't have an MBA. And so I figured, they're not going to hire me. So 6 months passed, they called me for another interview. This was the 6th one. I ain't not going to any more interviews. You got the job. Well, the job didn't pay very much. I was making some big bucks at Barker's because I was working eight days a week. There's only 7 days a week. Felt like 8 days a week. And I took the position. And I loved every minute of it. And I worked my way up within 6 months to what I was making at Barker Brothers.
Wow.
And I was supposed to be part-time. Mm-hmm. And they gave me 15 Western states, and then they gave me the nation. And I've gone through 24 bosses in 25 years. And I think after 30 years, which I finally retired from the company 2 years ago, I think I paid my dues on the mouse.
I would say so.
But we had a lot of fun with working with Phil Collins and Elton John and Vanessa Williams, all the big movers from Pocahontas to Lion King to Tarzan. It was just a beautiful, beautiful time to be with that company. And now all the gold and platinum records I have, and I probably have over 150 of them, I didn't know what to do with them. The wife just put them up. So I have them up from the ceiling to the floor.
Absolutely.
And people come over and they go, how'd you get this? And I said, I'm just mousing around. Just mousing around. So, but they've been good to me. So now, basically, I'm just painting. I'm going to have my 3rd showing. I've done very well on the first 2 showings that I sold paint. I don't know why they bought them, but people said they liked what they saw. So
what kind of paintings do you do?
Well, I call it primitive art. Primitive art is a mixture of oil and acrylics together, so I can get those vivid colors that oil comes in, mm-hmm. and then the acrylic is the impulsive, so I don't have to keep going back to the picture and changing the picture. I want the picture the way I feel it while I'm painting. When I paint with oil, oh God, I want to tweak it a little bit, and it's still wet, and you go back and you changed it. You changed the impulsive part.
Did you do this years ago too?
Never did the oils, no. Just I was always, in school, it was always design, architectural design, interior design, it was always structure. It wasn't the free stuff.
But you're always an artist. You knew you were.
Yeah, I really. You give me a glass of wine, classical music, and put
and
me in front of a canvas. That's it. I mean, that's really where I get. I have a lot of fun. Or in a studio recording and writing. I got together with Freddie Boom Boom Cannon. Always saw him. We backed him up for many years. Being Italian, he's Italian. I said, Freddie, let's write a Christmas song. So we wrote a song called Santa, You're Too Fat for Me. And we put it around, and nobody wanted to play because they said it was too controversial about Santa eating too much. He's going to blow up. He's bigger than a Goodyear blimp. And, you know, he sneaks into the kitchen at Christmas night. I mean, that was what the idea.
But it's
the
true.
Well, sure it is. And you know what I'm saying? It's a novelty. It was
right.
Like, you know, Grandma Got Ran Over by a Reindeer type of of approach. So we had fun recording it. I recorded our daughters, two country songs that we wrote for them. I brought my wife in to sing background.
She sings too?
We have an album out. Had an album out called Heaven Bound. Mm-hmm. And Tony Scotti and the Scotti Brothers produced us. We had six chart records.
Oh, he goes way back, doesn't he? To Annette Funicello at Disney, doesn't he? Didn't he do something?
The Scotties did, but Ben, Tony, and Ted Scotti, they own Scotti Brother Records that have James Brown, and, well, they had Joey Heatherton, and they own the rights to all the Baywatch distribution, so on and so forth. In fact, I just met Ben. I said, what are you guys doing now? He said, we don't have to do nothing. We live on one block, the whole family. In Beverly Hills. What about your sons? Oh, they live across the street.
It's a family affair, right?
And he said, we sold their company to King World, which is unbelievable. But it was very nice that we said, so Tony says, give me a copy of the record I was on with. I don't have a copy of it.
Uh-huh.
I said, you produced it. And the wife sang lead. Mm-hmm. And Michael Lloyd was on the back.
Yeah.
And Tommy Oliver of Name That Tune was the mm-hmm. arranger, Tony and myself. And they did a sketch of us for the cover. And I had a mustache then. I said, he made me look like a drunken Dean Martin. What is this? Take the mustache off, you know. Use a photograph, you know.
Yeah.
But that we had six chart records with that. We had covered Breaking Up Is Hard to Do by Neil Sedaka. And then we did He'd Rather Have the Rain by the Partridge Family. And Mother Country, which is a TV commercial for United Airlines that Joanne did. So they released that as a single.
Mm-hmm.
And we did very, very well with that. We actually got paid.
You got paid.
We got paid. That it was a great hit, Heaven Bound. So get on the website and look for it. I mean, I bought a jukebox so I could put all these old 45s in, so I and the kids can listen to it, because they were only released on at that time mm-hmm. on 45s.
Well, that's what I have at home. I have hundreds
of
45s. Of 45s.
Yeah. So I have a beautiful Seaburg that plays 200 plays, and I got it so it's a free play, so people come over. I even got the money bag where I can take the quarters out if they want to put it in. So you don't have to put a quarter in. I got like six free plays. Let it go. Sorry, you'll need it for the kids' college, you know. So,
uh-huh.
So the Seaburg is there at the house is a nice touch with the gold records that I have on the wall. So you look at your life is halfway through, let's say. Mm-hmm. It ain't over. But
you
it's halfway through.
Business, right?
Yeah, so it's, as far as the music and writing songs, and my son's now into it, and I'm helping him. He's got a band. It was a band called Torn by Night, and I think now the next one's called Resurrection or something. I don't know what the name of it. It's all this weird stuff that they're playing, but it's still music.
Yes.
And
it's not
still
like I Live for the Sun.
No. At least you could sing that. But Repetition did sell.
Yes.
Repetition did sell. So I'm very proud of Chris and my daughter, who's going to be graduating from beauty school. I got her wired, hopefully, in the movie industry to do makeup and hair.
Great.
I got a lot of contacts to help her out. I'm so, I wanted to do this earlier, mm-hmm. but she wanted to live her life just like we all did.
Right.
And now she's able to go forward with her cosmetology and her makeup. So I'm very, very thrilled that she found a niche.
She's another APSer because it's Tommy Cole.
How do you know? That's our first contact.
Tommy Cole.
Oh, hey, Tommy, you got to watch the show. We just pulled it out. But he's a good singer.
Yes,
he's
he is.
He's a very good singer, Tommy.
Yeah. And a nice guy.
And a very nice guy. So that's basically what I'm doing now. And then I've started this book called The Beach Boys and a Sunray. And it's basically detailing my life from that part of me getting into the music and getting paid for it.
Mm-hmm.
And into the part of being with Murray.
And you're,
big
you're
part about Murray.
And you're also doing the good part of Murray, because, the public has always thought he was horrible.
It's all going to be the good part of Murray, yeah.
Oh.
Half the book will be dedicated to what he has done for charity, what he has done for certain people that I don't want to mention on this show, but, and of course, meeting Charlie Manson is a whole chapter on with me and that whole thing. That was a scary thing. And all these chat groups on my site want to talk about that, and I'm not interested in talking about that. But the most exciting thing was getting a phone call from Dave Marks, the original Beach Boy that Murray kicked out of his house because he wouldn't take his amplifier across the street to his house.
And that was
Murray said, take this amp and put it back in your house. The Sunrays are coming to rehearse. And he said, And Murray said, And that was the end of Dave. So Dave had a rough go of it, but he's done a lot of music with a lot of same friends that I've done music with. And he called me up, and we're supposed to be doing our first show, June. Can I mention it?
I think you can.
Just June 13th at the Warner Center Park, Music in the Park. And it's going to be Dave Mark and the California Girls with Billy Henchy of Billy, Desi, and Dino.
I'm going to be there.
And Jeff Good.
Yes.
And Jeff Foskett, who wrote all the Sunray songs for the movie of the Beach Boys. So he's probably going to sing the high part because I certainly can't. So we'll do our little segment, and Dave will do all. And he was on like 10 of the first Beach Boy hits, so that's going to be fun doing that with them because we used to do those songs anyways in the Sunrays. And then Billy, of course, will do his hits. And then I don't know who the Beach Girls are. I haven't met them yet. They're probably, hopefully, they'll dance around and make us old guys
their
look.
Little bikinis.
Yeah. Who wants to look a bunch of old guys singing surf music? If we sound good, it's a different story, which we probably will, because experience
is all
that.
Well, that sounds like it'll be fun, because it'll be at a park.
Yeah, yeah.
And is this going to be on, I don't know when the, is this on a Saturday,
Sunday? I think it's a Saturday or Sunday.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't know. So, it's and I'm writing, in the process of writing a Christmas song, not writing Christmas songs. I want to have one Christmas song hit. I don't want to have any top 40 hits anymore. Mm-hmm. I don't want to even think that way. And you're going to say, why would you do that?
Why would you do that?
Because that'll be played every year when I'm gone.
That's right.
And that money will go to whoever, kids, their kids, or society, or charity. It won't just be a one hit. Mm-hmm. I dated Tammy Torme, excuse me, but I did. And I met Mel, and I asked him how he wrote the Christmas song, and he said it was on 120 degrees in Phoenix, and I wrote it in 20 minutes.
And that's probably one of the biggest ones that, I mean,
everybody's covered.
Everybody's
covered it, and his royalty checks on just that one song back then were huge. I could give the number, but I'm not going to. I'm sure it's larger than that now. But just that one song, and
wow,
it's so nice because so many you hear it every year. And that generation dies off, the next generation hears it every year. And that's really a good form of art, when you can
Absolutely.
Take a song like that. And a Sinatra song is the same way, but when you do a Christmas song as a writer, not even a performer, who cares who sings it? You know, as you get older, you just hope somebody does your songs. And, you know, I've got like 80 of them at Sea of Tunes, which now Alamo Music owns, that I hope somebody will listen and cover, that are pretty decent songs. And they can put it to a rap beat, they can, you know, lyrics are there, the idea.
Are you working on the Christmas one now?
Yeah. So Dave said, we met each other at the Shea Jays at a Beach Boy bash, and Dave, I said, let's write a Christmas song, because I said that to Freddie, Santa Utef, and we did it. So he sent me a tape, fantastic tape, and I'm halfway done with it. See, I said, when you do something like that, you get an idea, and then you take that idea, and you, rather than just sit there and leave it in a drawer, you work on it, you know, and so it's a challenge. And that way he can come back to me when he says, hey, that sucks. Or why didn't you do it this way? And then you start to collaborate. And that's when it becomes really, really fun.
We might have to look forward to it this year.
Well, that would be nice.
Yeah.
That would be nice. Yeah, that would be nice. And so I've got enough Christmas songs from asking people to write with me, not to go down the list to put out an album of Christmas songs of famous people that have written with me. And that's the whole idea, is have people that are good writers that have had hits. That can put this Christmas, and I don't mind giving it to charity. I'm not the money type of a guy. It's just to say I've done it. Just to say I've done it, you know. So as far as that with Eddie, it's been a cool ride. It ain't over. I told you I did some extra work in the extra business.
That's a trip.
And the best part of that is the food. Food is so great. And when the director...
Well, it doesn't look like you're getting
Well, you know, what happens is I piece.
Oh, you're
I piece.
The...
And then I some of these people are camera hogs. I've never seen them like it.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
The director marks me off at this one thing, which I thought, hey, I'm going to be on camera, you know? I've never been on a silver screen. So I'm getting all this item. Some of this guy comes up and pushes me off the mark. So I stayed off the mark. The camera says, didn't I tell you to stay over here? The director comes back. And then he says, I want you to go in the back to the guy that pushed me off. I wanted to go, see? listen. Should listen to directors, you know. And then this one woman, not to talk Hollywood, but this one woman said, we were doing Something's Gotta Give, and the director says, now walk real fast in front of Jack Nicholson, to me. So I walk, and this lady knocks me off my balance.
And she knocks you off.
She knocks me off my balance. So I said, you know, you can't win for losing. So I haven't done anything this year. I'm just painting. I could say I've done it, just like that, and you move on, and you move on, and you move on. But the kids keep me. We do dirt biking. We surf. Chris and I, we play.
You're surfing.
Oh yeah.
Even with a board.
Oh yeah. Oh
it's
yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, up at Trancas, we have a little spot up there. I go with Ricky, who wrote I Live for the Sun. He's a great surfer. He lives in Little Doom, Point Doom, but we surf Little Doom, and we go up there and. You know, when there's a lot of people, I don't get up. I just sort of look cool.
That's great. You have a very fulfilling life.
Well, I want to thank you for having me on this neat show.
Yeah, it went by so quick.
That's it already?
Yes, we have.
You covered everything. See, I told you, isn't that awful? Well, I want to thank you very much for having me on this show. It's been really fun.
And anytime you want to come back, and you have that Christmas song.
All right, and the book, I'll give you. The book's going to be fun because there'll be a lot of stuff that's not going to be.
Yeah, that really.
I'm going to even mention names.
Are you going to mention names in the book?
Yes, I
am. Oh, good.
A lot of names.
That'll be great. So I'll be anxious to read that. When do you think that will be done?
Well, I hope by next year. I've written it three times, and every time I go back to rewrite it, I go, yeah, I forgot to put that in. Mm-hmm. I forgot to put that in, because I should have been keeping a log like you probably have a log or
diaries. How long
diaries.
Have you been working on it?
2 years.
2 years.
Mm-hmm. What 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to wrap it up, and I want to thank you again.
Thank you very much.
It's really
Jodie,
great.
It was fun.
Yeah, it
thank
really
you.
Was.
Enjoyed it.
And as I said, anytime you want to come back.
You got it.
Come on.
All right.
I got it.
You got it.
Yeah, that'll be great. So.
Go! Sun, 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 sun. You can't